Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Welcome. Welcome, Church Online, to our gathering today. You may have your cuppa and your biscuit ready. You may be in the car and ready to go somewhere. Or you may have your earbuds in your ear and runners on and ready to go for a walk. Whatever your situation, we are going to worship. We're going to worship together as Christ's body, the church worldwide. We're going to worship our God through our praise, through our song, through our prayers, through communion, and with our hearts tuned and ready to hear God's word for us today. So let's pray. Loving God, we pray for our world. Loving God, we pray for our country. Loving God, we pray for our state and local areas. Loving God, we pray for our families. Loving God, we pray for ourselves as we come now to worship. We pray for us with our inadequacies and our competencies, and know that you are ready to receive what we are going to give. Thank you that in Jesus' name, you make all things possible for us. Are we ready to worship? I'm ready to worship. Hear these words from Psalm 148. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord from the heavens. Praise him in the heights above. Praise him, all his angels. Praise him, all his heavenly hosts. Praise him, sun and moon. Praise him, all you shining stars. Praise him, you highest heavens, and you waters above the skies. Let them praise the name of the Lord, for at his command they were created. Are you ready to praise? I'm ready to praise. Let's praise.
Oh, your good news spreading. We thank you that you are powerful, that you are creator, that you are majesty, that you are awesome God. And we pray that your spirit would be released across Australia, across the world, across the church, and into our homes today. We love you, God. We want to build your kingdom here with you.
A number of weeks ago, some of you might be aware of this, but Buddy Franklin kicked his 1,000th goal. I'm not personally a Hawthorn supporter, but kicked his 1,000th goal. And as the ball went sailing through the goal, someone grabbed the ball and off for Swans. Yeah, sorry. Thank you, everyone. In my mind, that's how much I follow football. In my head, he's a Hawthorn player still. So I'm just back in time. Anyway, don't spoil the story, Bob. Come on. I've got a thing going here. All right, so he kicked his 1,000th goal. The ball went sailing through the goals and some guy nabbed it, took it home. Now, this ball, in of itself, it's just a ball, isn't it? Like, it's just a ball made of leather, with stitching on it, with Sharon printed on it. It's just a ball. But there's only one ball that was kicked through those goals for that 1,000th moment for Franklin. Only one ball is that significant thing for him. This ball is a symbol, isn't it? It symbolises the years of work that he put in as a player. It symbolises all the practice he did, all the weights he lifted, all the sprints that he did. This ball was a symbol. It's more than just the leather and the stitching. And each week, we come to communion as well with symbols. We have them in our hands. Juice and biscuits, they're symbols. In and of themselves, they don't mean a lot, but there's tremendous meaning and hope found within this little biscuit and this little amount of juice. These symbols say to us as the people of faith that life triumphs over death. These symbols say that hope can be found in darkness. These symbols say that welcome can be found for all. These symbols say that God will stop at nothing to seek those who are lost. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 17 to 24 says, "For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, that is for all of you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after the supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.' For as often as you eat and drink this bread, drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." We take these symbols, this bread, in remembrance of Jesus. We drink the juice in remembrance of Jesus. And so these things aren't just memories to hold on to. They're also a call to faith and action as well. That as we eat and drink, that we are being called to embody the living presence of Jesus in our world. So, please make the lovely sound we've become accustomed to, the ripping of the bread. It's a lovely sound. And I'd like to pray for the bread before we eat it. Let's pray. Lord, this is the symbol of an outward body, a physical presence. It's a symbol of Jesus who hung out with those on the margins, brought inclusion to those who considered second-class people. It's a symbol that Jesus exposed the hypocrisy of the religious establishment and said instead that God loves and includes all. As we eat this bread, our calling is to be living like Jesus. Amen. Let us eat. And then if you can open up your juice as well. And I'll pray for the juice before we share it together. Loving Lord, this juice is a symbol of the lifeblood that can sustain us, keep us going, inspire us to be agents of transforming hope in our world. May we be spiritually fueled by this symbolic food this day, to embody the very goodness, kindness, love, peace, patience, and holiness of Jesus. This day as we drink, let us drink in the love of Christ, who is our light, our guide, our sage, our source of hope, and the one who demonstrated the costly reality of a love that embraces all. Amen. Let's drink together.
To follow Jesus.
Good morning, my name's Bindi and I'm bringing the Bible reading this morning. The reading comes from 2 Peter chapter 1 verses 1 to 11. Simon Peter, a servant and apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who, through the righteousness of our God and Saviour Jesus Christ, have received a faith as precious as ours, grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has given us everything we need for life and godliness through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these, he has given us his very great and precious promises so that through them you may participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to your goodness knowledge, and to your knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But if anyone does not have them, he is nearsighted and blind and has forgotten that he has been cleansed from his past sins. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never fail, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Hola, buenos dias.
Pedro's laughing.
Hello, good morning. How are you? Now, some of you may know that was Spanish. Not very good Spanish, I may add. Some of you may know that I'm learning Spanish. Some of you may even know why I'm learning Spanish and how. I'm learning Spanish on a language app on my phone. I'm learning Spanish because I like languages. It's better to me than doing, I have to look at this word, Sudoku. I always get it muddled, as you know. Or crosswords. So it's good for me to keep my brain active. And I like the sound of Spanish, especially after having walked in Spain
back in 2018 when we could go overseas. But I have to keep working at my knowledge. Peter, in this second letter to his community, his second written sermon, we could say, has a lot to say about knowledge. Has a lot to say about false teachers too. In just these first 11 verses, Peter mentions it 5 times. Peter also has a lot to say about faith, as well he might, as he was the disciple who knew Jesus was the Christ, and he walked on water with Jesus. But, as we know, he was also the disciple that denied Jesus too. We could do well to learn from this fellow. I rather think he might be a lot like the rest of us disciples. Insightful, dumb. Courageous, afraid. Well-meaning, judgmental. Faith-filled, faithless. Inconsistent, just an ordinary human being. A human being like us, loved by God, but not at all able to live out our calling of loving to God's standard by himself, just like us. He needs help. At the AGM, Becky spoke about how we, as a community of faith and as individuals, have a lot to readjust to. After 2 years of living with a pandemic, which continues on, as we know, and multiple lockdowns, which, praise the Lord, will not continue on, we've been told. Even though we may be coming out of this pandemic, life has not yet returned to what we might have thought of as normal. We have a lot of readjusting, reorienting, rebuilding to do. A lot has been lost, changed, perhaps even forever. Even the way we think and speak and act as church community has changed. So this morning, we're focusing on re-establishing our calling. That was the topic for today. Calling. Isn't that what Peter had as an apostle? Peter had a job to go out and tell people about Jesus. Isn't a calling something that ministers have, or missionaries, or perhaps doctors? Or teachers? Well, yes and no. It's true. Those folk do have a calling. But Scripture tells us very clearly that we all, as followers of Jesus, as disciples, are all called to follow him. Jesus calls us, invites us, and shows us the way to be in relationship with God, just as he was in relationship with God. Jesus calls us, invites us, and shows us the way to be in relationship with others too, just the way he was in relationship with others as a servant. This calling stuff is priority stuff. Jesus was once asked, "What is the greatest commandment?" And he responded, "To love God, to love others, as you love yourself." Simple, right? Full stop, end of story. You've heard it all before. I could just stop there, couldn't I? We could knock off early. Could be a really short message. But I won't, because we know that's not as simple as it sounds. We know this is not easy to do. So let's explore just a few elements. Faith. We are called to and have a precious faith, says Peter. Believing precious promises given to us by a loving, faithful God who tells us we are good with him. We're in good relationship with God. The perfect, all-knowing, all-powerful, ever-present God says we are good with him. Our imperfection is no impediment to God. Our doubts, our fears, our lack of faith doesn't stop the relationship from God's perspective. It may have once, but through what Peter calls the righteousness of Jesus Christ, that issue is resolved. And so too is the issue of thinking and believing that actually, I'm not such a bad person. I'm not a rotten person. I'm certainly not as bad as that person. And look how long I've been a person of faith and how long I've been coming to church. God's gift of grace says that counts for diddly squat. Grace, God's gift to us, tells us God did it all for us. God corrects our faulty thinking about ourselves, as communion reminds us each week. God corrects our faulty thinking about ourselves around our superiority and our inferiority, because God sees us exactly as we are. And most remarkably, abundantly and generously, God gives us divine partnership rights. Peter says God gives us divine power and divine nature. That's remarkable. Faith, believe it and live it. Peter continues, faith, goodness, knowledge. Let's just stop there a moment. What amazing things we can know about our faith. Dig deep into Paul's letters. Well, dig deep into Romans in particular. It can almost mess with your head. It's so complicated and deep. Man needs to use some commas, I think, but I'm not sure they were invented then. But you can dig in really deep and get to know an awful lot about God and how God sees us when you read the book of Romans or any other letter in the New Testament. You can do a bit of fact-checking there. But, like my Spanish lessons, 5 minutes every night, I can feel quite proud of what I know and my mostly pretty good score, depending on how late I do the lesson. All of my knowledge counts for nothing. Counts for very little if I don't practice it, if I don't act on it. I've never changed a car tyre, but I think I know what to do. I've watched YouTube. I've seen Michael do it. I think I'll be fine. Any bets on that one? A couple of weeks ago, I looked after our granddaughter, June. We were playing some games, beginner games, learning to take turns, learning to lose. What about learning to read or write or learning to count, learning times tables, learning to walk in high heels, not for all of you, learning to knit, learning to sew? There's one thing in common, isn't there? Practice. Do it. Repeat, repeat, repeat. In terms of our message for today, we're encouraged to re-establish, reactivate, consolidate our calling of following in the steps of Jesus. Love God, love others like ourselves. Keep practicing. Peter says, make every effort. Faith, goodness, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, mutual affection, brotherly affection, I think Bindi read out, and love. I'm not going to unpack them all, but let's have a look at love. How are we going with that one? How are we going with love? How might we be practicing that part of our calling? Love. How to love. Check the list again. Faith, goodness, knowledge, self-control, perseverance, godliness, mutual affection. Or check the list in 1 Corinthians 13 if you want an easier version. Or Romans 12, You might prefer that version, or read any of the letters that are in the New Testament to get some idea of how love works if you're not sure. And I say that because there are lists in the scriptures, our great guide. They're right there in our hands. Or maybe we've got them tucked away on a bookshelf and haven't looked too often. I'm not saying this to guilt you, but to encourage you, because I've heard us say, I don't know how I can deal with that person again. That person drives me crazy. They make me so mad. I'm so disappointed. So what about how to love? What might that look like for us? What might that look like for you, for me? It's going to be different for each one of us. Or we could think more broadly. How are we, as individuals and as church community, contributing to our worlds, our communities, like Jesus did? Bringing in the kingdom of love, of peace, of shalom, of well-being, the kingdom of heaven on earth. How are we partnering with God in re-establishing the Garden of Eden? Are we like beautiful potted colour that you get at Bunnings and spruce up your garden? Brings such joy, doesn't it? A little bit of colour here and there. Or are we a bit like weeds? Wrong place, wrong time. Let's break this down a bit. Attitudes, words, actions. Attitudes. Think, are we joyful potted colour or are we weeds? For the sake of peace, for love's sake, for God's sake, for the kingdom of God's sake, we may need to change some of our attitudes. Are we usually right about something? Everything? Are we a know-it-all? We've got all the answers, practically, financially, politically, theologically, psychologically, philosophically, the list goes on. We've got your answer for you. Or are we a smarty pants? We know exactly how it should be for you. Or perhaps we may think we have nothing at all to contribute. What are we doing about our attitudes? It's a matter of our hearts, isn't it? What are we feeding our souls on? Newspaper? TV? Radio? Facebook? How about scripture? Prayerful reflection? Devotion books? Reading and listening to the wisdom of the truly wise? Someone like Nelson Mandela, maybe. Or someone else that you know of who's truly wise. This comes down to a bit of a matter around humility. Because as Peter says, we can be nearsighted and blind about ourselves. Are we allowing others as people of peace and love to remind us of what's right and the sometimes narrow path of following Jesus? Sometimes we can come across strange prophet-like people like Melchizedek back in the Bible, way back, who came out of the city of Salem, Jerusalem, to bless Abraham. Out of nowhere, sometimes out of nowhere, I hear a prophet-like person encourage me on the radio, a really positive person. What about our words? What are we saying, or perhaps not saying? Are we speaking out words of encouragement when someone could really do with that? And who doesn't need encouragement? Or, on the other hand, do we need to hold our thoughts and mind our words? Maybe we need to speak less and listen more or listen better. If you want some hints on speaking, turn to the book of James. He has a lot to say about the tongue. How about our actions? What are we doing? What acts of kindness, peace and love are we engaged in on the home front, at work, in our clubs, when we're out walking or shopping, living our lives? I'm not thinking here about some grand continuous improvement plan like some workplaces have, but rather as individuals and as church community too. How are we partnering with God? How are we sharing in the divine power and sharing in the divine nature? Back in the story of beginnings in Genesis, it tells us about being ourselves. We were designed to be walking and working in the garden with the Creator, with Saviour God. And God's Holy Spirit enables us even now to do that again through Jesus. So being ourselves, what might that look like? Do you know who you are? You know your name. How well do you know yourself? What does God tell you about yourself? Is God telling you that you are loved? That you are worthy, you are special, you're accepted? What impact do our attitudes, our words and our behaviours have on others, though? That's us being ourselves too, isn't it? The shadow side, some people might say. Our realisation is we're not perfect. Life is not perfect. But there are some things we can do. Positive things we can do. We can follow in Jesus' steps, confirm our calling, keep stepping and practicing. So, a couple of more practical ways we can help others, as well as ourselves, to live the best lives that they can have. Be there. Listen. Love. When I worked in aged care a number of years ago, I learned that just being there was a way someone could feel God's love for them. Just being there. That's important to me too, as friends have sat with Michael and me in the ashes of our sad news. And I think many of you have experienced similar when you've had tough times, when someone just sits there and listens to you. No advice given, just listen and love. What about praying for godly wisdom and direction? Ideas come through God's whispers. You may have experienced that. I've noticed God doesn't usually yell. I think he keeps that as a last resort. Check in with others though, because sometimes a whisper could be our own mind. You want to check in with others who know you well, who know the scriptures well, and actually may know better. What about some of the big stuff? Here's one for our modern times. Can we share our homes? We have a housing crisis. High rentals, unavailable rentals. Do we perhaps have a space we could share with others? Maybe temporarily. I'm not saying anything permanent. That's between you and God. Can we share our wealth? I think many of us are here in this community. Can we share our time? Can we share our focus? You know very well as folk that are part of this community, how this community is offering love and hospitality through lots of different ways. Through our community meals, through playgroup, through the Hub Cafe, through kids and youth ministries, supporting overseas missions, local missions. Maybe there's more. Maybe there's more we can do in following the calling of Jesus, following in his steps. Well, wrapping up. Peter writes in verse 10 of our passage, confirm your calling. Confirm that calling of following in Jesus' steps. Contributing to our worlds, our communities, wherever we connect, in our going. Just like Jesus did, loving God, loving others as himself, bringing the kingdom of heaven on earth, returning and re-establishing the Garden of Eden, lots of potted colour. So three ideas we've explored today. Faith, know who and whose you are. Have a clear picture of yourself. Let's have a clear picture of ourselves and our good God and how our good God thinks about us. Knowledge. Do what you know. Let's keep practicing what we've learned, like my Spanish, or we may forget. Or like my French lessons, which I did forget. That was way back in high school. And my Hebrew and Greek at college, I've forgotten because I haven't practiced. We have to keep practicing love. That's what Jesus did. And love. Above all, love. Be a lover, not a fighter. Basically, Scripture says, all you need is love. Could be a good line for a song, that. Grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. Amen.